Welcome to our Wednesday study. It would be nice if you ladies can please come a little bit forward. There's only a few people. Let's not be so far away. Before we begin our topic of today, remember we will be continuing with our study of Daniel. With our study of what? The book of what? Daniel, isn't it? And we are encouraged by the spirit of prophecy that these Daniel and Revelation are the books that we should be studying. We should study very carefully because there's a lot of information for us today, isn't it? And that's what we've been doing. We started with Daniel 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, so now we're at chapter 5. But before we begin, let us all kneel and pray and ask God to be with us as we begin our study. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace towards us. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you that you have been with us even right through the day, protected us from the dangers that are seen and dangers that are unseen. We thank you for your many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. We ask for forgiveness for our sins, our iniquities, and our transgressions. And as we know that you have told us that in the last days, trials and tribulations will thicken even more, especially now for your people. And we thank you that you are always with us. You promise us that you will never leave us nor forsake us. I pray today that you please bless us with your presence. Let your spirit abide with us. Come and teach us the things that we need to learn. I pray that you please hide me behind the cross as I'll be presenting. And that this is a study where all of us must speak and talk of the things that you've shown us in your word. Please be with us, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. If I'm not mistaken, I believe there's a... Before we begin our study, there's it there on the board. What does it say? What does it say? Daniel chapter 5, what is the topic there? It says there, unseen watcher. The unseen what? Watcher. Or also it is called the what today?
The fall of Babylon.
The fall of what? Babylon. Before we begin, let us all go to the book of Proverbs 16. Proverbs 16. I hope everyone brought their Bibles. For no man can go to even a soldier can't go to war without a Bible, isn't it? So let us, if you have your Bible, please take it out. If you have your pad, if you have your phone, it is a nice thing now that we have Bibles on our phones now. So we can't have an excuse and say, I don't have a Bible, isn't it? That's a good thing, isn't it? That's what the good thing that we can say or that comes out of our phones. Proverbs 16 verse 18. Who's going to read it for us? Remember, this is a what is it? The study. Everyone can say what you see and what you understand in this. Proverbs 16 verse 18. What does it say? Is there anyone who's going to read it? Pride goeth before what? Destruction. And a haughty spirit before the what is it? Fall. So if you are a proud person and you do not change, your destiny is fall. You definitely gonna fall. That is your destiny. Even us, we are not exempted from that. It's said that if we still have pride, we are gonna fall. What caused Lucifer to fall from angel or to be banished from heaven? Pride. It was pride, isn't it? It was pride. It was pride that has prompted this world where we are today. It is because of what? Pride. And it says here, today we're going to find out that in Daniel chapter 4, King Nebuchadnezzar was humbled by the God of heaven. So if he was humbled, that means he also was what? Once proud, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And he finally acknowledged that Jehovah was the God of gods and the Lord of lords, even his God. How beautiful is that? Do we all know that, right? We know that in chapter 4, he was what? Humbled, isn't it? He even acknowledged God as his God, isn't it? And he says, this shows now, listen to this. This shows us how God dealt with him is the same way that God deals with us. God, it says here, even though he was stubborn, he had pride, God never stopped dealing with him and teaching him. And it says there, this was a pagan king. If God was so interested in a pagan king, how much more is he interested in us? That is the plan. That was God just wants to do. It is in him to save, isn't it? And not to be to give up. Those are the things that we're supposed to learn from who God is in these studies. We do not just hear to listen and understand what happened to Daniel. There's a teaching in each and everything that happened, isn't it? And it says here in chapter 5 of Daniel, we see, now listen to this. It says in chapter, we were speaking about Nebuchadnezzar, isn't it? It says in chapter 5 of Daniel, we see Nebuchadnezzar's grandson now. Who was his name? Belshazzar, isn't it? And he says, his grandson being tested like he was tested like Nebuchadnezzar was tested. But through his pride, he chose to continue in rebellion against God. So these were two people. The grandfather was also proud. He was stubborn. He was rebellious. But God never gave up on him. And he was what? That pride was broken up, isn't it? And then he came and acknowledged God as his God. Now comes the grandson. He also, God gave him chances and chances. God dealt with him also. But what happened to him? Did he make it? No. He never made it. He made a naked. It says he rebelled against God and his word. He did what? He rebelled against God and his? Wow. And his word. Let us now go quickly to Daniel chapter 5. Let us all turn to Daniel chapter 5. Where are we going?
Daniel chapter
5. Daniel chapter 5 we're going to. Daniel chapter 5. I want us to look at what was the grandson of
Belshazzar.
Let's go to Daniel chapter 5.
Verse.
And let's read from verse 18. Can somebody read from verse 18? This is going to confirm and tell us that he was so stubborn, he didn't even make it. Daniel chapter 5, verse 18 to verse 23. What does it say, Sister Candace?
O thou king, the most high God gave Nebuchadnezzar thy father a kingdom and majesty and glory and honor. And for the majesty that he gave him, all people, nations and languages trembled and feared before him, whom he slew.
Whom he would he slew. Yes.
And whom he would he kept alive.
Okay.
And whom he would he set up. And whom he would he put down.
Mm-hmm.
But when his heart was lifted up and his mind hardened in pride, he was deposed from his kingly throne. And they took his glory from him. And he was driven from the sons of men. His heart was made like the beasts, and his dwelling was with the wild asses. They fed him with grass like oxen, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven, till he knew that the Most High God ruled in the kingdom of men, and that he appointed over it whomsoever he will.
So this confirms exactly what I just said, isn't it? That Nebuchadnezzar was stubborn, he was proud, but at the end, God, he saw what God wanted to teach him, isn't it?
Amen.
And he was taught, isn't it? And he humbled himself, and then he lowered himself. He acknowledged God as a sovereign God. Let's look at verse 22. Let's look at what Belshazzar, what happened with him. Verse 22.
And thou, his son, O Belshazzar, hast not humbled thine heart, though thou knewest all this, but hast lifted up thyself against the Lord of heaven, and they have brought the vessels of his house before thee, and thou and thy lords, thy wives, and thy concubines have drunk wine in them, and thou hast praised the gods of silver and gold and brass, iron, wood, and stone, which see not, nor hear, nor know, and the God in whose hand thy breath is, and whose are all thy ways, hast thou not glorified.
So did Belshazzar know what his grandfather went through?
Yes.
Did he know?
Yes.
He knew, isn't it? He knew. He knew everything. His grandfather taught him. His father and people that came after him, his father and others, they taught him. He knew everything. And yet, what did he do? He chose to rebel against God. So, between Nebuchadnezzar and Belshazzar, who was in the worst state?
Belshazzar.
Why?
Because he knew.
And Nebuchadnezzar didn't have no what? No example in front of him, isn't it? Isn't it? But this, except when Daniel and them came in, isn't it? But he saw it straight from his father and his grandfather, but he chose to rebel. It says here, from Prophet and Kings, it says here, this is page 522. He says, many had been his opportunities to know the divine will and to understand his responsibilities to of rendering obedience thereto. He had known of his grandfather's banishment by the decree of God from the society of men, and was familiar with Nebuchadnezzar's conversion and miraculously restoration. So he knew what happened to his grandfather. He knew. He had no what? He had no check. He had no excuse. Brothers and sisters, Nebuchadnezzar is a type of God's people today. Most of us, we have seen what happened with the Israelites. We have seen what happened with we saw how God has dealt with the people that rebels against him. And yet, we are still doing the very same thing. Is it true, Sis Mandy? Is it true, Akim? An example ahead of us. So God demands more from us. He demands more from us. And we cannot have an excuse and say we didn't know. We can't escape. We are weak, brothers and sisters, if we do not repent. Some of us, God forbid, that we're gonna end up like Belshazzar. And some of us are going to end up like Nebuchadnezzar. These stories are not just tales that are put in there for us. There's a learning for us that we need to learn from, isn't it? It says here, those who have been so stubborn and rebellious that they would not humble themselves to receive the light God sent in mercy to their souls, became so destitute of the Holy Spirit that the Lord could not use them. This is some of us. There's still a chance though. Unless, is God a merciful God? He's too merciful. God is too merciful. He says, unless they are converted, these men will never enter the mansions of the blessed. That is from PC, which is the Paulson Collection, page 156.4. So we need to stop our rebellious state and come out of it and give ourselves fully unto who, Malika? Unto God. Let's start. It says here, let us start. We're going to be speaking about who? Nebuchadnezzar's son.
Grandson.
I just want, just go up. It says there, okay, let's go. Come down. So, thank you. It says here, wonderful lessons that, please read, Sister Kenneth.
The wonderful lessons that God had taught to Nebuchadnezzar resulted in his spending the rest of his days worshipping the true God and being a good and merciful king to his people.
Amen.
He died about August, September 562 BC and was succeeded by his son Evil-Merodach.
Yes.
Who reigned only 2 years.
Nebuchadnezzar,
his son-in-law, 4 years.
Yes.
Nebuchadnezzar.
Nebuchadnezzar's son,
9 months.
Yes.
Which being less than 1 year, is not counted in the kingdom of Ptolemy.
Yes.
And lastly, Nabonidus.
Yes.
Am I right?
Nabonidus. Yes.
Who became king in 555 BC and shared the royal power with his son Belshazzar. Nabonidus was away,
okay,
perhaps at war, and the haughty young king Belshazzar was left to manage the great city of Babylon.
Amen. So, Belshazzar was ruling with his father Nabonidus.
Yeah.
He says he was away, but I believe. Look, I believe something. As he was away, who came to take Babylon, to bring Babylon down?
The Medes
and the Persians, right? So I believe that as he was away, that whole Babylon was under siege already. The only place was not yet siege taken was the city of Babylon itself. So probably he was also captive already, the father. That's what I believe when I look at it in that way. Remember, Babylon was a region, big region. And when the Darius came to take over the city, I believe it was the last act now. When he was away, he could probably got caught in their siege as well. That's what I believe. I'm not saying it's like that, that's what I believe. All right? So, what did Belshazzar do to honor his idol God? What did he do? Chapter 1, Daniel 5, verse 1. Let's read it. Daniel 5, verse 1, what does it say? Let's read it on our Bibles. Yeah, let's read it on our Bibles. What does it say?
Belshazzar the king made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the 1,000.
Aha. So, what did he do? He made a feast unto who? Unto his gods. And then what did he do? He
drank wine.
He drank wine. He made so we can say he made a party, isn't it? What? So he says that even though there was trouble around him, he still found time to make a party. Why? Who can tell me? Jeremiah 17 verse 5 will tell us. Jeremiah 17 verse 5. Let's go there. Even though there was trouble around him, he still decided to hold a party. We're going to find out. We're going to understand that he knew there was trouble looming, or there was trouble around him. Verse 5, what does it say? It is because he did what? Thus said the Lord.
Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man, and maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departeth from the Lord.
Aha! So what made him to be so strong, and even though there's trouble around him, and still went on to have a party? He trusted in men. He trusted in his own flesh. He never trusted in that divine being, which is the God of heavens, isn't it? He trusted too much on what? On self. That's what happens to us, brothers and sisters, isn't it? We do that. Even though, look at us where we are now, in the point of time where we are, in the history where we are. And yet, some of us are continuing as if there is there's no more, we are not under the judgment. We are not under judgment. Why? We're still trusting what? On ourselves and men and everyone that is around us. To show that he had no respect for God, what did he do? Verse 2 to verse 4 tells us.
Yeah, the vessels.
Amen. What does it say? Let's read it. No, you don't have to go there, but listen, stay there on that book. Everyone must go to their Bibles. What did he do? Because I'm going to want you to go to that podcast. What did he do?
Belshazzar, whilst he tasted the wine, commanded to bring the gold and silver vessels, which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple, which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives and his concubines might drink therein. Then they brought the golden vessels that were taken out of the temple of the house of God, which was at Jerusalem. And the king and his princes, his wives and his concubines drank in them. They drank wine and praised the gods of gold and of silver, of brass and of iron, of wood and of stone.
Did you hear that? He says here, Belshazzar, while he tasted the wine, we can underscore wine there, he commanded to bring the golden now vessels. I want us to underline vessels as well. And then it says, these vessels were brought by his father and taken from the temple. And where was this temple at?
Jerusalem.
Now, I just want us to look at something. It says here, we're going to come, okay, let's go to page 61, Brother Dustin. Page 61. I will just tell you where it is. Page 61. Page 61. It says here. It says here. He, the prince, I think it is... I will tell you now. Paragraph 3. I'm looking for paragraph 3. Paragraph 1, 2, 3. He decided, you see there?
Yeah.
Okay, please read it, what I'm saying.
He decides to prove once and for all that his grandfather's true God is nothing.
No, did you hear that? He proves to say your father, his grandfather's God is what? Nothing. Is
it?
He intentionally did it. But it's a beautiful thing to say this man was a pagan, a rebel. Now he's our God, the God of heaven, is now called his God.
Yeah.
So now his son, grandson, defiles his father's God. Mm-hmm. Okay, what does it say?
Maybe some of the older nobles had reminded him that Nebuchadnezzar's dream showed that Babylon would fall. We don't know. But here's what he did. With reason dethroned through shameless intoxication and with lower impulses and passions, now in the ascendancy, the king himself took the lead in the riotous orgy. As the feast progressed, he commanded to bring the golden and silver vessels which Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives, and his concubines might drink therein. The king would prove that nothing was too sacred for his hands.
Did you hear that? That is the worst defiler bed. That is, I don't know. He says, nothing that is sacred in my realm. But this is very scary. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, what he did, we still do it ourselves. We do it ourselves. There was ancient Babylon, but we're going to come back to it. It says that the sacred vessels from the temple of God. These are what? Underscore vessel, if you have it in the Bible there. Or put it in your mind. They said the sacred vessels from Jerusalem, from God's temple, are brought, and alcohol is poured in them, and they drank out of them. And then it says here, he poured alcohol unto them, and they drank out of them, laughing and joking about the true God. Do you understand now what God says? Jesting and joking, he doesn't laugh, he wants it. Can you see where does it belong, jesting and joking? It doesn't belong to us. It doesn't belong to God's people. It says that when they were joking, they were doing what? Joking about who?
He says they were joking about the true God. That's what they were doing. Mm. Now listen to this. And he says here, of the Jews, in the next verse, it says, we are given a thought. It not says that there's a thought that they may even have, he brought the sacred golden sticks.
Also, to put it there in his party, to do what? To display. That's how he degraded God. There was nothing unto him that was sacred. Let's read it. Next. As the party carried on what happened? Let's read from verse 5 to verse 9. Quickly. I want us to say verse 5. Can I read it? In the same hour. Okay, please read it. I will tell you it. Please listen to this. Here is the king. He made a party. He brought the vessels because he was drinking wine, isn't it? And then he's with his people around there, isn't it? And then as they're drinking the wine from the God's vessels, what does he do? And these are sacred vessels, right? He does what? He mocks God. He shows God that God is what? Nothing. Read it there.
In the same hour came forth fingers of a man's hand and wrote over against the candlestick upon the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. Mm-hmm. And the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Mm. Then the king's countenance was changed and his thoughts troubled him, so that the joints of his loins were loosened, and his knees smote one against another.
Okay, stop right there. Where is there that it says there, the writer said he thinks that the candlesticks were even brought as display. Where do you see there? In the same hour came what? The finger of a man's hand who wrote over against what?
The candlestick upon the plaster of the wall.
Yeah. So, we might look, the way he degraded God, he might have even brought those candlesticks. Mm. You can't argue and say, maybe he didn't, it was too sacred. To him, it was nothing. He didn't care. He didn't care. Mm. That's what he says.
Why was the hands, they were the candlesticks?
Exactly.
It was probably to show that these things belong to God.
They belong to God. Thing. And then he says there, look, he, no one knew that there was one who was what? Watching over his things, isn't it? They didn't know. They just go on and carry on. They didn't know. Jeremiah 23, verse 23 tells us, he says, I am God. And it says, am I a God at hand? Said the Lord, and not a God afar off? Can any hide himself in secret places that I shall not see him? God is everywhere. That's what he was telling, showing them when he wrote today. And he says, said the Lord, do not I fill heaven and earth, said the Lord. So they were all in their party, giving, praising their own gods. But there's another in the midst of them. And what? Unseen watcher. He was there. Psalms 139, quickly, let's go there. What does God say? Psalms 139, from verse 7 to verse 10. Who's going to call them with me? Psalms 139, verse 10. Verse 7 to 10.
Mm-hmm. Whither shall I go from thy spirit, or whither shall I flee from thy presence? Mm. If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there.
Yes.
If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. Mm. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me.
Mm-hmm. So what was God, what does Psalm say? It tells us God is everywhere, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So even there, in the presence of the Lord was also there watching. And seeing what is happening. Brothers and sisters, that's what happens with us. We might do things secretly, but we must not forget that God is watching. Mm. He's always there, isn't it?
Yes.
He's always watching. He's always watching us. So, who can tell me? That was literal. What made Babylon fall? Mm. That Babylon, literal Babylon, what made it?
Pride of Belshazzar.
Pride! Pride! Mm. And not only of Belshazzar. It came all, let's read Revelations 18 quickly. Let's all go to Revelation 18. Let's go to verse 5. But we're still going to come back to the other verses. Revelation 18, verse 5. Revelation 18, verse 5. It says here, this is what made Babylon to fall now. It says, for her sins have reached unto heaven. And God had what? Remembered her what? Her iniquities. God has remembered now what? Her iniquities. And it says here, who can tell me now, this was Babylon. What did they do? Let's go back quickly to Daniel. Let's go back. What did they do? Daniel 5 and verse, we're going to come back to Revelation. Daniel 5 and verse 5. What does it? What did, verse 4, it says here, I'm going to start from verse 2. Belshazzar tasted the what? The wine. And he commanded to bring the gold and the silver, what? Vessels. And then from they were taken from the what? The temple of the Lord. And that temple, where was the temple? In Jerusalem. And then what did they do? They drank wine. And they praised the gods of silver and gold and wood and all of them. That's what the literal Babylon did, isn't it? Tell me now, what is going to be bringing the fall of the spiritual Babylon? Isn't it the same thing? Mm-hmm. Revelation 18, let's go from verse 1 now. Revelation 18, verse 1. Let's look at this thing. I just want us to look at something there. What does verse 1 say?
And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, mm-hmm. having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory.
Okay, verse 2, and saying what?
And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, behold, the great Babylon the great is fallen, is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean
and hateful bird. Why? For the all nations have drunk of the what and the wine. Of the what of the bread of the fornications. And then it says there now, it continues, says, I've heard another voice, says, please come out of her, do not be partakers of her sins. Now tell me, what does one represent in the prophecy, in the Bible?
Doctrine.
Teaching, right? Doctrine. Now, what does those vessels, what do they represent? What else are vessels in the way of God?
God's people.
God's people. Let's go there. 1 Samuel 21, verse 5. 1 Samuel 21 and verse 5. Let us just see what is the the spiritual Babylon doing. Also, what did the olden Babylon did? Ancient Babylon. 1 Samuel 21 and verse 5. 1 Samuel 21 and verse 5, 20, yes, please read it.
And David answered the priest and said unto him, of a truth, women have been kept from us about these 3 days,
okay,
since I came out, and the vessels of the young men are holy, and the bread is in a manner common, okay, yea, though it was sanctified this day in the vessel.
Okay, so tell me, what do the vessel represent, as Sister Candice said?
Amen.
It represents what? God's people, isn't it? Mm. Who are officiating in God's office.
Mm-hmm.
2 Timothy 2, let's go there from verse 19. 2 Timothy 2 from verse 19. 2 Timothy 2. 2 Timothy 2. We're going to come back to 2 Timothy 2 from verse 19, yes.
Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his.
Uh-huh.
And let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity.
Okay.
But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth.
Okay.
And some to honor and some to dishonor.
Okay, verse 21. If a man
therefore purge himself from these,
yes,
he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use.
Amen.
And prepared unto every good work.
So these are what? God's people, isn't it? So doesn't Babylon taken people
people who are supposed to be working for God and have changed them so that they can be a use for to spread the word of God in a false manner. Isn't it? I don't know if you are you getting me? Are you understanding that? Yes, Brother Kim?
2 Corinthians 4 verse 7.
Okay.
We all know that verse.
Okay, what does it say?
It says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us.
Amen. Amen. So, Babylon, the people that are, let me put it even in this way, even us, Seventh-day Adventists, there are doctrines that we are teaching of Babylon. Do you know that?
Yeah.
We do. So we also have become drunk with the wine of the wrath of what? Or the fornication. Even us, God's people, as that literal, what he did, he taken the vessel of God and then put it here and then used it for unholy use. That's what God's people have done. There's people, even most of us, Seventh Adventists, we still stand behind the pulpit and still serve the people of God, the wine of Babylon. Us, even ourselves, that's what we do. Amen? Then that is very scary, isn't it? Isn't it, brothers and sisters?
Yes.
It is. What did he do, Belshazzar? What did he do as his grandfather did as well to show that he doesn't believe in God? Verse 10 to verse 12. What did he do?
Now, can I read?
Yes.
Now the queen, by reason of the words of the king and his lords, came into the banquet house. And the queen spake and said, O king, live forever. Let not thy thoughts trouble thee, nor let thy countenance be changed.
Mm-hmm.
There is a man in thy kingdom, in whom is the spirit of the holy gods, and in the days of thy father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, was found in him.
Mm-hmm.
Whom the king Nebuchadnezzar, thy father, the king, I say, thy father, made master of the magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers.
Mm. Did you hear that? So, what did he do? He says here, listen to this. He says, now there's an interesting page 63. Okay, more up. He says, there's an interesting fact in this. He said about these words. Oh, the writing on the what on there? Wall. There was a writing on the wall, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's why he said the hand came and wrote. Listen to this now. The king could read them because they were in his what?
Language.
But he could not at all understand why they were there and what they meant. Oh. What actually were these words? They were what? Numbers. So these words that were there, he could see, he could read it, but he couldn't understand it. Isn't that what's happening with us today? These were in his language, in his own language. But he says he couldn't what? Understand it. Why? Because these are the language of what? Of heaven. What language was that? The judgment language. Do we, brothers and sisters, do we know that we are under the anti-typical Day of Atonement? Do we know it? I don't know. Do we know?
Amen.
Sisters in the faith, do we know that we are under judgment?
Yes.
Do we know? Okay. Do we understand that we are under judgment?
Amen.
No, we don't. Because if we did, we would stop sinning against God. So he saw, he could read it, but he could not understand it. That's what's happening with us. We know we are under judgment, but it is like this, what happened with him, it is exactly what's happened with God's people. We are under judgment, and yet it's like we do not understand. Why am I saying that? Because we are continuing to live the lives that we are living, or we've been living, as if there is no God. He could not understand it. He lived. He was there. And what did his writing say? Okay. Verse 25. What did the writing say? Verse 25 to verse 29.
And this is the writing that was written.
Yes.
Mene, mene, tekel, ap, harasim. Thus is the interpretation of the thing. Mene, God has numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Tekel, thou art weighed in the balance and art found wanting. Peres, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Then commanded Belshazzar and they clothed Daniel with scarlet and put a chain of gold about his neck and made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom.
Brothers and sisters, do we understand that actually even in our lives the writing is on the wall? Do we understand it? The writing is on the wall. Can't we see it? But there's going to come a time where these words are going to hit us hard. Am I wrong? We do understand. Look, we can see, isn't it? We can read in between the lines that we are under judgment and everything where we are. We can read it, isn't it? But we can't understand it. Why? Our lives shows us we can't understand it. Because if we did understand it, we would cease to sin. What does this mean to us? It means if we continue in rebellion and pride against God and refuse to be reprimanded and repent, as the fate of Belshazzar will be our fate as well. If we do not what?
Repent.
His fate will be our fate as well. Mm-hmm. Where do we find it? Daniel 5, let's look at verse 27. You read it. What does it say?
Thou art weighed in the balance and art found wanting.
When is this going to happen unto us, brothers and sisters? Revelation 22, verse 11. These same words, that these are other words, but the context is the same. Revelation 22, verse 11. Yes, thank you, Akim. Are you going to read it for me, please, Akim? Revelation 22, verse 11. What does it say?
He that is unjust, let him be unjust still, and he that is filthy, let him be filthy still, and he that is righteous, let him be righteous still, he that is holy, let him be holy still.
So these words, brothers and sisters, and then verse 12 now says, behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give to every man according to his work. Did immediately when that writing was on the wall, did the reward come for Belshazzar?
Yes.
Immediately. Immediately that his reward came. That's what's going to happen to us. When we do not want to make right with God, there's going to come a time, and immediately when that time comes, we are in trouble. We're going to receive our what? Our reward as well. Did he receive his reward?
Yes.
Did he?
Yes.
When did he receive it? The other time?
The same night, the same time.
Immediately he received it. That's what's going to happen to us if we do not change. I just want to go quickly to this book. Great Controversy, page 491. Yes. 491, paragraph 1. It says here, it confirms now what Brother Akim read now. He says, the righteous and the wicked will still be living upon the earth in their mortal state. Men will be planting and building, eating and drinking, all unconscious that the final, irrevocable decision has been pronounced in the sanctuary above. He didn't know that today I'm not going to make it. He didn't know that his hour was what? His door probation was closed. That's what's going to happen to us one day, brothers and sisters. It says here, how? He says, silently unnoticed as the midnight thief will come the decisive hour which marks the fixing of every man's destiny. The final withdrawal of mercies offered to guilty men. That time is going to come unto us. You know why it's going to come unto us, and it's not going to, surely it will come, because we know better.
We know what is ahead of us. Those people out there will still have a chance. Why? They still have to come in because they do not know. But us, we know. We know, brothers and sisters. He knew better. He knew. And yet he decided to do what he did. We're done. Are we getting what was happening here?
Amen.
Do we get it?
Amen.
What is God showing us?
Amen.
Exactly what? I don't want Belshazzar's fate to be my fate.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want it to be my fate. I'd rather choose the fate of Nebuchadnezzar.
Mm.
But we don't know where we are. But the way we're carrying on, brothers and sisters, it says, whatever we sow in here now, we shall reap. If we are clinging to the things of the world, clinging to pride, brothers and sisters, pride is what is killing us. Who took over Babylon? The Medes and the Persians. Isn't it? And how did they conquer it? How did they conquer it?
Through the
verse 32, verse 31. Let's read it quickly.
Was dried up.
Let's read it. 32, verse 31.
Five.
We're finishing now. Can you see? It was a very short study.
In that night was Belshazzar the king of the Chaldeans slain, and Darius the Median took the kingdom, being about 62 years old.
It was what? Being what?
62 years old.
He took the what then?
The kingdom.
Now tell me, this is what happened here now. Them coming in. Because of pride. Did it happen before in Daniel? The very same.
Yes.
A little bit of it. Did it happen?
Mm.
Where? In Daniel chapter?
Chapter 4.
Verse 30. Let's go there quickly. Let's look at something quickly. We're done. We're close. Daniel chapter 4. Verse 30. This was a fall of Babylon fully. But there's a little bit. How can I say? A miniature of what happened now. It happened in Daniel chapter 4, verse, I believe it's verse 30. Read from verse 30.
The king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty?
Yo, who was this? King Nebuchadnezzar. What was found in him there?
With those
pride. And then what happened? Verse 31. What was verse 31? This, look, immediately there was a voice that came down. This is what happened. Immediately there was a hand that came in and did the very same thing. What does it say? Verse 31.
While the word was in the king's mouth, it fell a voice from heaven saying, O King Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, the kingdom is departed from thee.
Did you hear that? Immediately. So this was a miniature of what was going to happen. And then it happened at last. How many things shows us in our lives that you're not right with God? How many things shows us? How many times does God show us and try to wake us up?
Every morning.
How many times?
Every day.
And yet we're not getting it. If we continue in pride, pride comes before the fall. Did you know when he says Nebuchadnezzar, Belshazzar, he was a worse foolish king. Do you know what he did? Let's just read it quickly. I just want to read it now. We're done. He trusted too much. Page 66. I'm looking for page 66. He says here. He trusted too much in himself. He had so much pride. He saw they were camping there. GC. I mean, the same book. They were camping around there. Yes. Do you know what it did? They were camping around there. They had so much. We know how big their walls were. That's what brought him. That's why he trusted in men. That they would protect him. There was so much big. Okay, there's it. Under circumstances, it seemed to make the... I wanted to ask this question. Why did this man say, I will make you the third ruler? Why? Belshazzar, he asked. He said, I will make you the third ruler. Who comes and explain to me these writings? Why?
His father was.
Because was it? Father was a ruler, and then he was a second, and then he was going to be. And then what did Daniel do?
He rejected
it. Why? Because he could not be bought. He could not be what? Be bought. And that's what we need in these last days, brothers and sisters. I know that God needs men who cannot be what?
Bought.
Or sold. Isn't it?
Amen.
Who will stand for the truth? No matter what happens. Isn't it? Exactly Daniel's example should be our example as well. So Belshazzar, he says, he was so confident that they had storage of food that would last them 20 years. As they were partying, look at him, celebrate person. As they were partying, they even took food and threw them down to those people. That's how boisterous they were. That's how much ego they had. They even threw food at them down there to show them that we have our own gods. We don't need no God. Nothing will happen unto us. That's what they did. Yes, Father Tyson, you wanted to say something.
I'm just thinking about the two kings, why Nebuchadnezzar was not punished. I actually wanted to go there before he told me to move. But Nebuchadnezzar, when he was taken into the wilderness,
yes.
How can I put it? God worked with him, but even though probation didn't close to him, but there was a punishment for the
sins, yes.
And for Belshazzar was different. Now, the reason why it was different is that Nebuchadnezzar, nowhere do you find that he played with God's vessels and stuff.
No way.
Anything that was sacred of God, he didn't tempt to make it a plaything.
Yes.
He would stay away from it.
Yes.
But when I look at that situation that happened with the 7 years with Nebuchadnezzar, the whole town, or probably the whole Babylon, or there was nowhere on earth that touched
his throne.
Where that words were, or that scenes for 7 years did not touch. Everyone knew he was made like unto an animal and was running around for 7 years. Because when he came back to his throne, he established a new covenant with the people. So he knew he was brought up, and as you can see, it says, that night, Belshazzar's kingdom was finished.
Yes.
He had transgressed past the point of return.
Yes.
His kingdom would be rent from him. So you can clearly see that a time will come if you are put in this position, either of Belshazzar or Nebuchadnezzar.
Yes.
The time will come where we will do certain sins. And when I look at it, Belshazzar was more involved with Christian things than Nebuchadnezzar, because he was, if you look at the candlesticks, he knew and he understood the most holy
place. Yeah, he understood it.
And the holy place.
That's how he brought it to defile
God. That's why he could bring it and defile God or tempt God even more than he could. And we can see the candlesticks represents either us representing the light or the Holy Spirit.
Exactly.
So he grieved the Spirit too much.
Too much.
To a point where, you know, it was unforgivable. And how much are we going to be? What more must God do to us that we must now understand and learn that we are grieving the Spirit by going against God's word?
Every day. Thank you, Father Tyson, to bring that up. Thank you. Yes?
I wanted to say exactly the same thing.
Exactly.
He said that the sin against the Holy Spirit will not be
forgiven. Will not be forgiven.
That's why he passed the point.
Yes. Can we see how hard this is, brother and sister? So, yes, the second is.
I was going to say, when I look at him, I see the same Spirit that was ruling and controlling Satan.
Yes.
And the same Spirit that controlled, what's his name, that betrayed
Christ? Judas.
Judas.
Yes.
Yes.
Hmm.
Like, even if he was pleading for another chance there, he would have, even if God gave him that chance, he would have gone back and done the same thing.
He would have done the same thing.
Yeah.
Brothers and sisters, let us, you see, at this moment, when the Spirit of God condemns us, convicts us, we need to listen. Because we're going to come to the point where there's no return. And we have passed that point. And what makes it past that point? It is because over and over the Spirit is speaking to us. That's what is speaking to us. And when we keep silencing it or rebelling against it, you can't. There's no way you can. What else? What other medium can God use to reach us? Yes, Father Tessin.
No, I'm just thinking now that what Kenneth is saying. You know, I lost it now. But I'm thinking regards to, it says here, Daniel told him that if God had to forgive you, he would do it again. In fact, he would have even ripped his neck apart. I think it was to him.
Yes, it was him.
It was him.
Yes.
Now I'm thinking that, you know, that very same words, Ellen White tells us to not to pray for certain people because of their diet and how they eat.
Yeah.
And how much more do we fall in that same wrongs? What? Are we not afraid that the day will come and God even tells maybe you to stop praying for me because I'm indulging in things that he's been telling me for years now to not do?
And do you know, to show this, that is the type of what's happening. There was trouble looming around. There was trouble. They were around, sieging that place already. Aren't we at that point at this moment? We are there. There's trouble coming, but we are calling on as if we're making party in our lives. There's a party, and what we do, we even take, he took food and threw it, and we don't even care what you do. That's what he was carrying on, and while the watcher is watching. That's what happened. Yes, Sister Candice.
I just want to read 1 John 5.
Yes.
If any man see his brother sin, a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. There is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. It's just on that.
Yes, what doesn't say it. Yes.
That even with spirit of prophecy says.
There's a sin unto death.
You cannot pray for the people that rebels against God.
Intentionally.
Mm-hmm. And they know what they're doing is wrong.
No.
Says that sin, it says, if there's a sin that is not unto death, ignorance or whatever, pray for these people. But when they sin a sin that is unto death, don't pray for it.
Brothers and sisters, we need to come to the point of repentance. Let's ask God to really help us. Angit?
Because we all know God.
We all know.
Sufficient light.
Something, there's
we're
no,
still doing the things
we're doing. Still doing the things that we're not supposed to be doing. Let us ask God now to have mercy upon us and give us the strength to stand up and make right. That's what we need now. We have become so weak. We have become so weak that we might even think that there's no point of returning this moment. There's still a chance. But let's fight it before we come to that point where there won't be a what? A point of return. I hope we have learned something today. And may the Lord help us.
Amen.
May the Lord help us. Is there anyone who wants to say anything before we pray? Is there anyone who wants to pray for us so that the Lord may give us the strength so that we can say no? Yes, Brother Kirsten, thank you. And yes to you.
Can I pray?
Yes, please.
Most precious Heavenly Father, to the thankful heart we come before thee. We thank you, Lord, for waking us up and blessing us with the gift of life. We thank you for the many messages we receive every day.
Yes.
And I mean every single day, Father. You speak to us.
Yes.
And we can see the love in it. And Father, I'm reminded, even though Belshazzar he crossed a point where he cannot return. I know deep down, Father, that you worked hard in trying to save him.
Yes.
And it's because of his rebellion and wanting to show off and show people that he is better than you. And putting his trust in men that he was cursed and he fell hard. So I pray, dear Lord, that since our ways of living is not the same as the way we profess to be Christians, forgive us, Father. Forgive us for bringing tears to the holy angels that comes to thee day and night, bringing feedback on how we are loving and representing you. We ask, Lord, that you may please help us to make right with thee and to become the vessels you want us to be, pure and holy. Help us, Father, to now minister to people by the way we love. May our thoughts change, Lord. Please sanctify our way of loving, our hearts, our minds. Father, take every filthy thing away from us and restore a new heart and a right spirit within us.
I pray, O Lord, that you may engrave these words within our hearts now as we leave. We may compare our lifestyle with either Nebuchadnezzar or Belshazzar. Or anyone for that matter in the Bible, Father. And may we choose to be like those fathers of the book of Hebrews, the ones of faith. For they one day will receive a reward and they will be with you until eternity.
Yes.
I pray for safe traveling mercies for everyone that will be traveling. And I pray, Father, that you also guide and protect us that will be remaining here back home.
Yes.
We ask this not because you're worthy, but we are in desperate need. And we ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, I care not for riches, neither silver nor gold. I would make sure of heaven. I would enter the fold in the book of thy kingdom with its pages so fair. Tell me, Jesus.